Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 29, recorded on the 29th July 2016. And there are 5 questions. But as usual, first the normal intro. Namo. Tasso. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha. The first question goes like this. It's a question 80. I'm extremely nervous when I have to talk in front of an audience. Is that a mental defilement? How can I work through it? Yes, the Buddha was very, very clear on that. This that one is nervous in public appearances has to do with moral transgressions. Usually it's subconscious. One doesn't know this oneself, and therefore this question is asked. It's because one has a backlog of wrongdoings, where one have done something evil, something wrong, something incorrect, and one is afraid of being exposed, that the other ones in society, in this public audience, that they come to know about what one did in the past. These wrongdoings, these moral transgressions, this lack of sila, moral purity, is usually subconscious in the sense that one does not necessarily have seen or understood fully yet that this was a wrongdoing. But nevertheless, mind knows it subconsciously, deep down. It knows that this was wrong because it's been in the same situation innumerable times. It knows that there is a punishment if the other people in society, the other beings in this public audience, they come to know about it. They will come towards one with blames and rightful accusations and eventually also punishment of one kind or another. So that's the fear of that is conditioning this nervousness, this feeling of insecurity, this fear in public audiences or among other people in general. So this is important to know this mechanism. If one has this social phobia, fear of being among other people, or fear of speaking of public audiences, of large amounts of people, then one should look back in one's past and see, what did I do wrong? What did I do wrong? Is there something I have forgotten or repressed or suppressed so much that I cannot even see it myself? This is a very useful mechanism that mind, if it sees something ugly in itself, then it just covers it over with neglect. So it never can kind of like directly comes into contact with its own transgressions. This is some work you have to do on the pillow, actually, and also doing reflection and being open for it, not being aversive to own wrongdoings, because this won't help at all. This is something that one has to see, that this maybe have something that has passed 20 years ago, that one had sex with another person's partner, or one did economical transactions that were fraudulent, or one stole something, or one cheated something, or one didn't deliver anything, something loaned back, or one did tax evasion or insurance fraud or something like that. Can also be other things. Usually also lies. So this is the 3 big classes, sexual transgressions, adultery, 2 lies, numerous of them, 5 per day, if we should believe the modern psychology. And then fraud and theft with economical transactions. Look back, was there something or not? This is the work one has to do, is to see the wrong as wrong and come to see the right as right, whether it is some action, some behavior that was done in the past or is being performed now or being performed in the future, whether it's one performing oneself or it's other that's performing. It's completely, one has to be completely indifferent towards that and see that wrong is wrong, right is right, neutral is neutral, whether done in the past, now, or in the future, whether I do it or somebody else is doing it. It has nothing to do with that. But usually one has an asymmetry of being very good at seeing other people's mistakes, but very, very bad, notoriously bad, and seeing own mistakes. So as soon as a mistake comes up, mind blinds itself and says, I didn't do it. Or I did it only little. Or I did it because of this or that circumstances that made me do it. So it wasn't really me that did it. It was the circumstances. And so on. All kinds of bad excuses. This doesn't help. This doesn't help. There's some hard work there to be done to purify this ethics, this morality, this sila. And again, this is to see the wrong as wrong and the right as right, whether past, present, or future, internal, own, or external in others. Basically, one has to come back. How can I correct it? You say, first of all, one should purify this past and see, come to see what there was of wrongdoing, then regret it, repair it if it can be repaired. That is to say, if you told a lie, tell those that you have told a lie, and apologize for it and ask for forgiveness. Ask for forgiveness for whatever wrongdoing. This is repairing. Repairing of the past is shaping the future, of course. It's improving the future. So repairing the past is fixing the future. Repairing the past is fixing the future. Because when you come, if you get forgiveness for whatever moral transgression you have done towards other people, if you get forgiveness for that, then you're back to zero. It's like a trace that has been erased. There's no trace anymore. There's no probabilistic, karmically active trace that will affect the future. So if this past trace is eradicated, then there's no trace in the future. There's no bad karma in the future. So repairing this past is really fixing the future. Then there's how not to accumulate more nervousness, more fear, more social phobia because of these moral transgressions. This is back to basics. This is back to the five precepts, to keep them pure. And this is not an easy thing. We just take them again. One is to avoid all killing. Of course, avoid all killing of human beings, but also avoid all killing of any animal, small as big. Anything that one can perceive is alive and has consciousness. That is, plants doesn't count, bacteria doesn't count, but any multicellular organism that has consciousness counts as being a satta, a sentient being. Avoid killing anything of that. Avoid all stealing, all fraud, all misappropriation of any kind of value. There's also, here also tax evasion counts and insurance fraud counts as stealing. You're stealing from the common society. Avoid all sexual abuse. Third precept, disavoid all sex with minors, and with others' partners, and those who are taken care of by others, that is insane people, or those who are in prison, those who are in the Sangha also, those who are taken care of by others, protected by others. They are not fit for sexual contact. Avoidance of all lying, of all pretending, of all presenting of any kind of state in a non-factual, non-actual way. That is, that you make it look like either whether you say it or one shows it or one puts it up on a screen or draws any kind of information that is put out there in the social sphere, that is like A, while one very well know it is like B. So it is a deliberate misguidance of society in the wrong direction. This counts as lying. This one should completely avoid. And then all, this is all dishonesty, basically. All abuse of alcohol and drugs, not prescription drugs. Because they cause carelessness and neglect. And this means that one will step over the line in the sand again if under influence of alcohol or drugs. This one cannot keep the other four precepts if one cannot keep the fifth precept of alcohol and drugs. So to purify these completely, 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 until they are spotless, the ancients say. Until they are completely unflawed, unripped, unbroken, continuous, unspotted, unblotted, like a white sheet, a tabula rasa, something that is completely clean. Come clean, friends. Then you will have joy. Why? Because innocence is obviously connected with absence of regret, absence of worry. Because there's nothing to worry about. There's nothing to regret. There's no bad consciousness. No bad consciousness, as we say. Huh? Not without a reason. So therefore, these five precepts is really back to basics. Imagine how many problems that will be solved in the world if all human beings were able to keep the five precepts. Huh? You'd need no police. You need no armies. You need no reporters. There would be nothing to tell about. So this is important on the social level and also on the individual level. In short, nervousness in public appearances, social phobia, or fear of being with other people are caused by moral transgressions, numerous often in the past, that is unseen and unrecognized and unadmitted by the mind. So the person has not seen these transgressions yet as transgressions. He or she will deny it. Did you do this and that wrong? Say, yes, I did it, but it wasn't wrong. Or maybe lying also, I didn't do it. Huh? So this one has to purify. This often takes years, where it comes dripping in, little by little, these memories of wrongdoing. And then one has to chew on them and realize it and see oneself in the mirror, really. And it's not an easy task because there is usually in our time a lot to see of wrongdoing and purifying by seeing it as wrong, admitting it to oneself. When one has admitted it to oneself and are able to admit it to others also, then this fear will evaporate by itself. Especially if one comes clean regarding the five precepts in the same period, and this usually goes hand in hand. Purifying the past, fixing the future by repairing by sticking with the five precepts. This goes hand in hand. This is Buddhist basics. It's as basic as it's come. When I say basic, I don't mean easy. It is not easy, but it's necessary. It's required before we start anything of the higher, anything of jhana, meditation, higher philosophy, higher level of understanding, insight, all these higher steps on the path, they have to have as a prerequisite, an indispensable precondition, this moral purity, this sila, sila visuddhi. So this just is easy to see, because you can say, if you have a lot of transgressions and you don't have dealt with them yet, then there will be worries rightly, because you're heading into a karmic catastrophe, yeah, in the future. So mind knows, and it starts, huh? And the closer you come to death, the more panic you see in people's eyes. And the second thing is this regret, that this takes away the joy, the gladness. When there's no joy, no gladness, no happiness, then there cannot be any samadhi, then any concentration, because this happiness causes samadhi, this concentration. So there could be no jhana, no concentration, no panya, no understanding. So people are stuck. They don't know why they are stuck on the path, but they are stuck. Why not? Because of lack of purification of the basics. It's especially a common problem among Western Buddhists, because in Asia, people know this from childhood. So they know what they have in their past, and they know where their own level more precisely. While Western Buddhists, as soon as they become Buddhist, then they think they're experts, and they have not even purified the basics. If you go down and look in the basement of their mind, or inside the cupboard, all the skeletons, they come storming out like a flood. You're completely hit down by skeletons in the cupboard, and by dirt under the carpet. This has to be clean out. Start with shoveling it out, then brooming, then a nail brush, and then lastly polish the mirror with a razor blade. Then after that, polish it with a cloth, a clean cloth. Then the mirror is clean. Then you can come to see what there is to see. When you see all that is in the mirror, you can see through the mirror. That's where it starts to get interesting from a philosophical point of view. When one is coming out of the house of mirrors. So, effect of old, long time past transgression can hang on for years, 5 years, 20 years, 20 lives. So it's a long process of hauling them out in consciousness and then dealing with them correctly. Usually just admitting it and regretting it is enough. Repairing the past is fixing the future. I think this is enough for question 80. Question 81, isn't the highest giving the giving of Dhamma? Was a Buddhist lady who asked me that, and this is correct. This is the highest giving. Sabbadana Dhamma Dana Jinati, said the Buddha. Sabbadana, all giving is overcome or conquered by giving of the Dhamma. The giving of the Dhamma supersedes any other kind of giving. Therefore, it makes me especially happy to give you this Dhamma. So why is it the highest giving the Dhamma? Because it's giving deathlessness in praxis. And deathlessness is the most valuable phenomena for all beings that can die. And that means all conscious beings. Because their main problem is this death of the body and death of the moment, that basically there is impermanence. So you are lost and you lose everything in every moment. And you lose also this body and you become older, decay, sickness. So it works on all time scales. So this is deathlessness, is repairing this otherwise inevitable sickness or disease in all existence, that it is impermanent and remains to be impermanent. We cannot make it permanent. Huh? we cannot get eternal life. We cannot keep the moment of joy, satisfaction in existence. It slips out of our hands. It slips in between the fingers. So you cannot hold on to it, even though we cling to it. And that's why clinging basically is suffering. If we could keep it, then there was no suffering in clinging. But since we cannot keep it, then there is suffering in clinging, because you're losing whatever you are panically clutching onto, whether it's life or the body or the youth or the beauty or the intelligence or the external valuables like house, car, wife, son, job, social status, whatever. Any clinging to any of that or anything else whatsoever. Basically, the five clusters of clinging. Cling to any form, any feeling, any perception, any mental construction, or any kind of consciousness, whether past, present, or future, whether internal own or external others. Clinging to any of that is suffering. So this giving a cure to this very deep down problem that is in the world, in samsara, unrepairable. It cannot be repaired by any other way or medicine or method. There is only this way of the Dhamma, basically the Noble Eightfold Way. It's the only method to escape this suffering induced by impermanence and thereby gain deathlessness. Gain nibbana, lasting happiness, absolute peace, and full freedom. It is basically because of that that the Dhamma is priceless. You cannot put a price on deathlessness. It is senseless because it's more valuable than anything in any world and in all worlds together summed up. So how to put a price on it? It is impossible to put a price on it. Therefore, we say it's priceless. It's priceless. And therefore, one should not put any commercial interest into spreading the Dhamma, because then one starts to put a price on the Dhamma. And this actually shows that one has not understood what one is trying to sell, basically. This one should not do. Because the Dhamma is priceless. It's a unique thing in the universe. It's the only exit, the only door out of samsara, the sea, the time sea, the time ocean of suffering that beings keep recircling in. Being born, aging, sickness, death, being reborn, aging, sickness, death, being reborn, aging, sickness, according to the karma, according to the quality of their behavior. So repairing this very fundamental as they come, problem of suffering. Giving people a medicine for that, the Dhamma, is of course the highest giving that you can give. That you can give. Happy is those who give the Dhamma. Happy is those who assist giving the Dhamma, who helped to give the Dhamma to others, who help others give the Dhamma to others. Happy they become. Why do they become happy? Because they do the best they can do. They give deathlessness to others. It's not only a very big thing, it is the biggest thing. Again, sabba dana, dhamma dana jinati. The giving of Dhamma conquers all other gifts. Basically, because impermanence and death crushes everything and everybody. And a cure for that is therefore priceless, absolute, and the highest, the supreme. So far from question 81. Question 82, what are the karmic consequences of arguing and backbiting with one's parents? Yeah, this is backbiting in general, and in particular with one's parents, causes ugliness, both in this life and also in a future life, in particular in a future life. So those who are very beautiful, they are mild-tempered in the sense that they can be angry, but they are not angry when they are scolded or when they are criticized. Then they don't backbite. They don't retort, come back at the point. They become silent. And this is, they can hold the horse back. They're not revengeful in their speech. And this is a high quality. So backbiting to parents has some further consequences. It is lack of gratitude when doing good to others. It is low or no honor, no fame or no praise, low social status and position in any society and group of beings. Why so? Because parents have given all joys you have in life. So one is in a big debt to one's parents. It's easy to see, because if we take the parents out of the equation, then whatever, the kid is not existent. If the parents didn't give birth to the child and brought them up, feed them up, take them into society, bring them to school, sports, and whatever they have done, then these children will not have any joys because they were not in existence, basically. So thereby, the parents are a direct cause to all happiness one has in this life. So one should be very grateful for that. Grateful for in the extent of one's entire life. So one is an enormous debt to, one owe enormous amount of goodwill and good doing to one's parents. And therefore, to backbite and criticize them in almost whatever situation, even when scolded, is a lack of gratitude and also a lack of insight into this debt that one inherently is in. Buddha, he exemplified it with saying that even if one took one's parents each on one's shoulder and carried them around in 100 years, and they urinated and defecated on one, and one have to take them down every evening and wash them and wash their feet and oil in their feet, even if one did that in 100 years, still one will owe them something. And secondly, he said, if one make them king over the entire and queen over the entire planet, then still one wants owe them something. So this says something, that this is a significant amount of good, and therefore is lack of gratitude, any kind of critique, any kind of backbiting, any kind of blaming one's parents, rightly or not so. It doesn't matter, really. There is a lack of gratitude there. That is very fundamental, because it's one's own existence that one's owe or have are in debt to one's parents regarding one's own existence. So therefore, one should be very grateful. I don't say it's always easy. There's many conflicts between children and parents, and also grown-ups and their elderly parents, and so on. So this is, there are conflicts or bumps on the road in any relationship between human beings. And this is inevitable. But one should be forgiveness and use patience in this situation, and then come over these bumps. And then one see them, turn around, when I've come over the bumps, then one turn around, see, when I was in this conflict with my parents, it was very serious for me. I could hardly bear it. But now I see it was only a minor bump on the road. Still, I'm very grateful to my parents. Still, I feel gratitude towards my parents. This coming home is a very common problem between youth and also grown-up, that they blame their parents for this and that. Sometimes they blame, and I think this is unrighteous, they blame their parents for their own happiness in life. And usually it's not the case at all. I said, there's two kinds of blaming. Usually you can blame society on your own unhappiness. It's your own unhappiness is called by society in this or that way. And then this is one big class of bad excuses. Then there's another big class. This is the parents and childhood. this is because of Freud, huh? Banal Freudian mistake. It's because my parents were so bad to me, and my childhood was so unbalanced and full of conflicts that I now feel unhappiness. Bullshit. It's because of own moral transgression one feels unhappiness. It's not because of other beings' transgression. One cannot, even in principle, experience other people's karmic results. One can only experience one's own karmic results. And this conditioning, Freud, any psychologist of today, though they are starting to see it, starting to recognize it, they don't understand this conditioning of the past. Though it comes straight out of quantum mechanics, that there's non-local conditioning of any state and non-temporal conditioning of any state. That is, any state in the past will condition any state in the future. So it's straight out of the box. It's not mystical, but it's not so easy to understand either. So forgive the parents, forgive everybody, but forgive the parents first of all, because then a big stone will fall from your heart and not weigh you down. As long as you're blaming the parents and backbiting, then you're blaming your own existence. You're uprooting your own existence. You're ripping the carpet away under your own joy and your own peacefulness. Because you're blaming somebody that caused your existence. And that is maximally a completely lack of gratitude, huh? Complete lack of thankfulness to an almost perverse degree. They have caused your entire existence and still one blames them. That's not correct. That's not decent. That's not righteous. So forgive them, forgive them, forgive them. Yes, they did wrong. Sometimes they did wrong. But so what? So one have done wrong themselves. So they one should use forbearance, forgiveness towards them. And then stop backbiting. So in short, again, the karmic consequence of backbiting with one's parents is ugliness, lack of gratitude when doing good to others, low or no honor, no fame, no praise, low social status, and low position in any society of guru beings in the future. That's what's the questions. Question 83. I have a friend who isn't Buddhist. She's not so good with morality. She drinks. She watches bad movies. Despite of these weaknesses, she did good things to me at tough times, giving me gifts. She's most of the time a nuisance, and she's very rude to me. Should I end this friendship with her? No. I think that, there can be various issues, but again, it's the same as the parents. This friend has her mistakes. Everybody has that, unless you're awakened, then you're pure. There's no mistake, huh? So she can be rude, but please know that if somebody is rude to you, it might be because you have been rude to others in the past. So it might just be a karmic echo. Then it doesn't, if you end the friendship with her, the other people will be rude to you because the echo is still there. One is dragging around this echo around one like a field of probability. It's also out there. It's basically non-local in nature. It is, which is the same as saying it is everywhere, present. This field of probability of experiencing rudeness that other beings are rude. So they are also affected by this field of probability. So this one cannot run away. It follows one like a shadow, the Buddha said. One cannot run. And this doesn't help then ending the friendship. And also she'd been good also. So look at that. Look at that. Then also know with people that are rude or have some problems in a relationship that they might have their problems. Look at with from a compassionate side. They might have problems in their relationships. They might have problems with their economy. They might have job insecurity, feeling lousy at the job, or being the next one being sacked. They might have problems with drugs. They might have health issues and various many other very common problems. So look at it from that. Usually when you feel pain, you will tend to be more irritable, more aversive towards others also, including your friends. So if one feels stressed to that side and doesn't see it, then one usually kind of like let it flow on to the next one in all one's relationship. This is not correct. This is not right. One should see it and keep the address. If it comes from there, then keep it there. The Buddha said, if there's fire inside the house, inside the relationship, inside the family, inside the job, inside whatever social, then one should not carry it outside, not carry it out in society towards other beings and let them be involved in it or feel the oppression of it or effect of it. And if there's fire outside in society, conflict, wars, no, one shouldn't, or at the family, or at the job place, one should not take this conflict or fight at the job place back into the family. So keep the address, keep it where it is, contain it where it is. Don't let the social damage, the psychological damage inflame or infect neighboring areas of your social life. One can call it the innocent bystander effect, that if one is a bystander with a friend that has a stress at his workplace, then one experiences this stress also because one's friend becomes stressed and more rude. So there's an innocent bystander effect there. And this one should try to abrogate in oneself and maybe also recognize in others. And this is using compassion. This is using understanding. This is using empathy. Try to understand if they're rude, if they're stressed, if they're out of balance, why are they so? Why are they so? Where does it come from? Is it yet another instance of wrong address? So this is like a letter of conflict. It's delivered at the wrong place. It's taken from here into there. It should just be kept there. So use this compassion. And then also know that the Buddha say, patience is the highest praxis. So patient kanti is the sixth mental perfection. This is something that you can practice everywhere, while sitting on the pillow, while being with your friends and they're being rude to you, while you have to wait in the supermarket or in the bank or at the stoplight or whatever, in whatever situation, while being scolded at the job place by your boss or wherever, when the monk says something to you that you don't like, wherever, use patience. It's the ability to endure the circumstances while looking at them, while being with them, while sticking with them, and then examining them a little further until one finds out, it's not like I see it. It's not like I emotionally react on it. It's in another way. So there's no need to this aversion or this attraction or this neglect. There's no need to. Just look on it. See it as it is. Just as it is. Just as it really is. Ta-ta-ta, the Buddha said. Just so. Exactly so. Such as such. Give space to others to have their weaknesses. Think, what is bugging them? Where's the bug? What is the bug? Can I help in any way? Then endure the rest. Then also, in any kind of relationship, because of impermanence basically also, there is bumps on the road. And these bumps one should endure. Endure. Friendship is the greatest. However, one should not need be friend with everyone. Of course, if this rudeness goes on for years, then one has to relax. How many times should one forgive regarding the same issue, the same rudeness, the same lack of understanding or the same neglect or whatever. The Buddha says six times. So you gave basically six chances. And he said, if they don't get it after the sixth time, you're allowed, you're blameless if you withdraw from them and don't speak the Dhamma to them. And thereby let them run out their line of bad karmic consequences. Six times. Not three, not four, not five, but six. So this is a good rule. And it's also, before you're finished with this six times, you have used patience a lot. You learn a lot of patience. Don't give other people's only six chances right in a row. Wait some months, give them another chance. Wait some months, come back, give them another chance. Let impermanence work also in a good way. So if there was a bump on the road, then the bump has passed. No problem. Come back to reality. Compassion, compassion. One of the four Brahma Viharas is something like also you can say pity, that you see people suffering. A good thing in a way to look at other beings, all sentient beings, is okay, maybe now they are evil and they do something wrong and they are rude to me. But deep down in their consciousness, in their heart, we might say, there's the root, the seed to enlightenment. One day they will also awaken. Then they will completely stop all conflict, completely stop all aversiveness, all hate. This will be completely evaporated from their mind. So this speaking to this enlightenment seed, this Tathagata Garbha, this Buddha nature in them, seeing this Buddha nature, that there is Buddha nature in all beings, from the ant to all human beings to the gods, there is this Buddha nature. Speak to that, stick with that, be with that, even when the times are hard and when conflicts are abound. The last question is question 84. I've seen people in the social media spreading bad views on Buddhism. I tried my best to correct them. However, they do not seem to understand their mistakes. Should I continue despite of their negative comments? No. Again, you can give these six chances, but in general, I also made these mistakes earlier on. And usually one get into disputes of various kinds, that is verbal or written conflicts that can start a war, actually, if they propagate long enough. There are various wars of these already. We don't need more of them, as you all know. Huh? So, don't get into religious arguments. It's not necessary. Just stay with the Dhamma. Know that 93.6% of all beings cannot understand Buddhism. So they are unable to understand. That this means that usually it's only one out of two school classes that you can do anything with. So don't discuss. If they are up and discussing, then they cannot just conclude, are incurable, cannot understand. Then go on with your own praxis or find somebody else who can understand. But usually they cannot understand. So that's a very common case. Don't fight with that. Start with these religious arguments. So avoid dispute in anything, and in particular in communication of Buddhism. And Buddha, he had a very famous saying that I'm also abiding myself. After I also myself initially get into these disputes earlier on, 20 years ago. And it's, don't agree. Don't disagree. Just speak the Dhamma. And that's the best way, is to say, neither agreeing nor disagreeing with other people's view, just speak the Dhamma. Just say what the Buddha said. And what his enlightened being said. And then usually that will resolve the issue. And then people can agree or disagree. That's their business. But this is the correct thing to do, is just to speak the Dhamma. Not agreeing, not disagreeing. This avoids all conflict and dispute. And still communicate what can be communicated and what should be communicated. The way to end suffering, the Dhamma. That ends Dhamma on air number 29. Thanks for the good questions. And thanks for all those who have recently helped me with food. I'm very grateful for that. It keeps me and three dogs and a cat alive at least a month. So thank you for that. May much merit be yours. As I say here in Sri Lanka, Bohuma Pin, it means may good merit, good future, good karmic response be yours. Thank you for your attention. Namo. Tasso. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable. And perfectly self-enlightened. Was a blessed Buddha.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha.